Flourish. I looked at the definition of flourish this afternoon, very important given I've been asked to talk about it. Flourish, to grow strongly, luxuriantly, to thrive, to be in a period of high productivity. Hence, I'm going to talk about my book. My book is called The Consolations of Economics, and it's very relevant for this evening, hence I've been asked to speak here, because it's about the global economy, and I believe that the world economy in the next 20 years or so will have one of its strongest periods of growth ever. Now, not everyone may agree with me, but the last time, as Steve touched on, that people maybe did disagree with me was before the financial crisis, when I was pessimistic, lots of people were upbeat. And there's a tendency in economics, but also in life sometimes, for people to think where we are now will continue. Before the crisis, people were upbeat, they thought the good times would last forever. In recent years, there's been a lot of pessimism. There clearly are risks in the world economy. We've had a very divided world economy, a very disconnected world economy. Youth unemployment is 1 in 8, so there are key challenges. And in terms of the world economy, I could quote you lots of statistics, but there are 3 types of economists: those who can count and those who can't count. So I tend to keep use of statistics to a minimum, but let me quote 3: 32, 62, 72. $32 trillion was the size of the world economy at the beginning of this century. We can't really picture that, but it was a big amount of money. The day the financial crisis started, the world economy was $62 trillion in size. And at the beginning of last year, when I started writing the book, it was $72 trillion in size. Latest figures suggest the beginning of this year, it was $74 trillion in size. You don't have to be an economist, but 32, 62, 72, 32, 62, 74. How can it be that despite the biggest financial crisis in 60, 70, 80 years, the world economy has continued to grow? Well, it's because basically jump on the plane and go somewhere far away and the world is very, very different. And in some respects, that's what I'm trying to do in the book. Go on a plane. Instead of seeing the world from 4 feet, 5 feet, 6 feet, whatever height we are, trying to see it from 36,000 feet. Like if you're on a plane, if you're lucky enough to have a window seat, as you come into land, if you come into land at a city you know very well, you tend to look out the window and think, gosh, I didn't realize that was there. And the world economy, in my view, if you look from above, is seeing significant change. So much so, I think we should be really positive. Let me give you some indications. I think there is going to be an arc of growth from China through India into Africa for one key reason: population growth. The world economy is growing very strongly. 1 in 12 people, 1 in 12, is an Indian under 27. India, like Africa, is seeing phenomenal population growth. But demographics can be a disaster if you don't plan for it. It can be a dividend if you do plan for it. And what we are now seeing across the globe is significant change compared to the past. For instance, across Africa, 650 million people have mobile phones. We're now seeing more middle-class people from across the globe, more people with spending power. Big institutions in America and elsewhere talking about 5 billion middle-class spenders in the next 15 to 20 years. So there's greater population growth, there's greater spending power. And cities, if we'd sat here or stood here 20 years ago, cities would have been a story of poverty, shanty towns, etc. Now cities are smart cities. London is one smart city, but there's greater innovation in terms of making cities clean, making sure that people can work there, making sure that we can do all sorts of things pretty efficiently. In fact, in the next 20 years, two-thirds of global growth, two-thirds, $2 out of $3, £2 out of £3, is expected to come from the world's biggest 600 cities. Of those 600 cities, currently 140 are in America and in Europe. But in 20 years' time, there will only be 20 in Europe and America. You're going to see cities across the globe that people now are aware of, but in years to come, they might work there and travel there. The 3 biggest consumer spending markets in 20 years' time are expected to be Dar es Salaam, Dhaka, and Lagos. But it's not just people, more people doing things, more people spending things. Innovation is a big driver. There's more innovation now, in my view, than ever before. But some economists are very pessimistic and say we've done all the big things. Nonsense. Japan, aging rapidly, is now at the forefront of robotics. In Northeast America, universities are focusing on genomics. Some people, seriously, smart people, believe that the first person to live to 150 is already alive. Some people even say the first person to live to 200 is already alive. Who knows? But while there are lots of young people in the world, what's probably more interesting, certainly for your parents or grandparents, is that the rapidly growing part of the world's population is older people. Not that being over 65 necessarily is old. Currently, over 65 count for 1 in 14 of the world's population. 20 years' time, 1 in 6. There's innovation related to spending power, but also there are big challenges. I'm very much of the view that there's too much pollution, too much corruption, too little clean water, too little cheap energy. I talk about this in the book. But what's really good nowadays is that when there are problems, there are innovations. People are putting their mind to work. Indeed, across the globe, you could argue that we're seeing the new industrial revolution. 3D printing is one example, green technology is another example. And on top of this, on top of perspiration, more people, on top of innovation, we've got new trade corridors. Parts of the world that used to trade just with America and Europe are now trading with one another. The biggest trade corridors globally are between Asia, Africa, Asia, the Middle East, Asia, Latin America, and you're starting to see India, you're starting to see Brazil, you're starting to see others come on the scene. China is a big part of the story. I could quote you lots of figures about China, but China really is a Robin Hood, Goldilocks, and Superman economy. And this doesn't translate very well in Chinese. They know who Superman is, but they don't know who the other two are. Robin Hood takes from the rich and gives to the poor, or took from the rich and gave to the poor. In the West, we tend to think of China. Indeed, we think of India, we think of Brazil, Indonesia as taking from us. You go to other parts of the world, and they see it in a different light. They see these big countries as markets to sell into. That's the Robin Hood. Goldilocks, the temperature had to be just the right temperature for the porridge, not too hot. The Chinese economy, and indeed you could argue the other economies across the world, they have to be like Goldilocks. Too hot, inflation picks up, the poor get hit hard, food price inflation goes through the roof. In China, they riot. Too cold, unemployment, migrant unemployment in particular picks up, people can't vote, they riot. So the Chinese authorities for 30 years have kept the porridge at just the right temperature. Amazing. But they're also a Superman economy, up, up and away. But Superman had a kryptonite problem. Lack of resources is China's kryptonite problem. And they do have a big kryptonite problem. So there are big economic trends, and these are making the global economic cake bigger. But you might think in the West, but that's okay for them. What about us? The great thing is that it's not just economic and financial power that's changing. Soft power is a key factor. What's soft power? He whose story wins in an information age. Wherever you go in the world, I would argue that the soft power still resides with the West. It's not just the clothes we wear, it's the music we listen to, the books we read, hopefully economics books, of course. But soft power, the West still has a lot of it. Hard power is military spending. Now, you might not think that's good, but 15 countries in the world account for 82% of military spending. America spends as much as the next 14 put together. And that helps drive scientific excellence, universities, and maybe one or two other things we don't like too much in America, but also across the world. In fact, the two key words, in my view, that President Obama has used in his first 6 years are the words pivot and. Very important words. America used to have a strategic economic dialogue with China. Then he changed it to strategic and economic. And you might think, so what? What it did is that it means, despite all this military spending, this is not a Cold War. Soviet Russia was against America. By making it a strategic and economic dialogue, he was buying China more into the economic way of life of America. And the Chinese are more capitalist than the West. Strategic issues still matter. Japan, China, India, there are lots of tensions and we shouldn't ignore them. And then there's policy changing. So in addition to economic and financial power shifting, soft power residing with the West, hard power, policy making is changing. We're now at the early stages of seeing the world move from the West running things to now seeing more and more countries across the world being embraced into this change. And this means that they can work together to address some big issues: pollution, corruption, increasing poverty. So there are challenges out there, but there are solutions. And what does it all mean to the conclusion? It means the global economic cake is going to get much, much, much bigger. The world economy, if it grows below 3% is weak, above 4% is strong. You might think, so what? Last year, to put it in perspective, the world grew 3%, this year 3.5%. You might not, how do you feel? You probably don't think great. If the world economy grows at 3.5% over the next 20 years, average incomes globally go up by 2/3. If it grows by a strong rate of 4%, average incomes globally go up by 80%. There will be some changes along the way. How do we succeed? How do we prosper? How do we flourish in this environment? The countries that do well have to have one of the three C's: cash, commodities, or creativity. Britain and London doesn't have much of the cash, maybe in some people's minds, certainly doesn't have the commodities, but we've got creativity in bounds. We need to thrive on that, flourish on it. Companies that do well are like individuals. When I speak at schools, I say, think of yourself as a brand. Think of yourself as investing in yourself as a brand. The brands that do well adapt and change. They play to their strengths. All of us have different strengths. We don't just focus on weaknesses. And we try and anticipate the future. And really, the ending story is like Crowdshare tonight. It's about thinking global, and it's about embracing change, and basically, hopefully, flourishing in what I think will be a very exciting future. Thank you.